Well, hello, my name's David Darlington. I'm a full-time audiobook producer, which involves an awful lot of different jobs from recording right through to final mastering, and sometimes even before recording. To explain a little bit about myself up front, I didn't actually train in sound per se. I was initially aiming towards graphic design, moved out of that into physics, and then into electrical engineering, I suppose. There was a small element of digital signal processing involved in my electrical engineering degree, and I found that thinking about that and its applications to sound editing and sound design was something that I was far more interested in than pure electronics. So I moved sideways into doing a PhD based on signal processing as applied to sound, then spent several years thereafter moving around slightly different industries and slightly different levels of academia, including 3 years just down the road at Heriot-Watt University, doing postdoctoral research into sonar. Ultimately, though, I'm not really a very good academic. I don't have the discipline for it. I don't have the application for it. I'm too flighty. I like being involved in a lot of different things. I couldn't just apply myself to one project for 3 years at a time. It would bore me incredibly. So while I was working in initially King's College in London, and then I moved to Queen Mary University of London in the East End of London, doing some study into wavelets as applied to sound processing. I started actually working as an editor for a company called Big Finish Productions, who at that time almost exclusively made audio drama. Audio drama being a thing which had almost been forgotten, except say on Radio 4 at that time. They set up in the late 90s, I joined them 2 or 3 years into the run. The ethos, I think, behind Big Finish setting up, it started, the thought was always that it wasn't to make just talking books, it was to make essentially audio movies. That sounds a little bit pretentious perhaps, but if you heard any of the early work, you would know what the thinking behind that was. They wanted fully convincing soundscapes which the listener was inside. This is a very long way, actually, from a pure audiobook. I'm going to come on to make those distinctions, I think, a little bit later on. But anyway, after a lot of years of working for Big Finish as a freelancer, working for BBC Audio as a freelancer, and a lot of other companies doing recording, editing, producing, final CD mastering, all those sort of things, I've now been for 5 years a producer for the Royal National Institute of Blind People. Producers of talking books, largely for their own library in the first instance, although they do also make some commercial work as well. We had a lot of work from, for instance, Audio Go, a company that's unfortunately just gone under, as you may have heard. The RNIB, as it's known, is actually the pioneer in the field of audiobooks. Back in, I think it was 1935, but I've certainly got some photographic support of this. It was about 80 years ago. They did the very first talking books, purely designed to be listened to by blind people. In those days, the equipment was obviously quite cumbersome. You were basically listening to shellac or vinyl records. As the years have gone on, this has changed through using sort of large cassettes, smaller cassettes, CDs. These days everything is done on MP3 CDs, so you can essentially get up to 24 hours of audio onto one disc, which is a very handy and simple way of sending it out to the end users. The ethos behind what the RNIB does, though, is that it's purely taking a novel or a set of short stories or whatever, or sometimes even a piece of non-fiction, biography, whatever the book is, and producing an audio version of that purely by giving it to an actor, and the actor reads it out. There is nothing else to it. It is purely a reading of the book aloud. There is, therefore, essentially no sound design. And when it comes to the much wider audiobook industry, that's still largely the case. It's certainly not exclusively so, but I'm aware that for the vast majority of what Audible does, a company you may have heard of, who are now that probably the market leader in terms of certainly online distribution of audio books. There's no scope for music or sound design, it's purely just a reading of the text. Audio Go, which was formerly BBC Audio, BBC Radio Collection, again, almost all of what they do in terms of audiobook production is just very straightforward just an audio reading of the text with nothing else added to it. No music, no sound design, no environmental effects, no foley, no nothing. There are exceptions to this, I'll come onto that in a moment. But, yes, I would say probably 95% of the audiobook market is exclusively unenhanced audiobooks, just the reading and nothing further.
Doubt if the neighbours would have spared him the lovely knowledge. He put his arm round her. Let's get on.
Before I sort of go into the distinction between audiobooks at one end, full cast audio drama at the other end, and the various shades you get in between those, I should describe how audiobooks are generally recorded. If we assume for the moment that we're dealing with a single narrator audio novel, there are two ways of going about this.
These were fragrant, colourless alcohols served from cut glass carafes.
You can have continuous recording, whereby if the narrator fluffs or has to turn a page or stop for any other reason, you just keep the recording going, mark up the script, mark up the project you're working on, and then edit it all afterwards. That's favoured with many people working in the industry, in the commercial arm of audiobooks, because it means that you have total control over the end product in terms of what you do and don't want in there. Nothing's likely to escape because you're editing it, checking it against the text continually. At the other end, there's what's called rock and roll, whereby anytime there's any kind of fluff or any kind of any moment where the narrator needs to turn a page, you stop, rewind back to the end of, say, the previous good sentence, switch into record mode at that point. The narrator will have heard their own voice. They come in and start talking at the right point in the audio.
Heaverside Road. I don't want to. If you're playing a game, then I am not. He took her arm firmly in this. Onward, Stella.
Sorry, Nigel, it's in heads rather than in this.
Oh, sorry. Side Road. I don't want to. If you're playing a game, then I am not. He took her arm firmly in his. Onward, Stella. You do remember this bit of your journey. Of course, you could lie to me, but somehow I don't think you will.
The idea being this is an extremely efficient way of working. At the end of the last session, you have basically a finished piece of work. You shouldn't need to then go in and edit it at all.
I would be listening to other people and noticing everything, I hoped. Learning, I hoped. And I would read, I don't like that, let me go through that sentence again, it's important. Anything that I was writing from the time I stopped writing until I started again the next day. That way my subconscious would be working on it, and at the same time I would be listening to other people, and noticing everything, I hoped. Learning, I hoped.
There are advantages and disadvantages to both methods. I mean, the first one, you're more likely to be absolutely certain that nothing's escaped that shouldn't have. However, it's much more expensive because it takes much more studio time. The second one is the method favoured largely by the RNIB, where I work as a day job. It's efficient, that's why. It's the best method of using your studio and your reader and getting the book out as quickly as possible. Different narrators are better at it than others, but it is a very good way of working. The title that was just recording, along with a lot of the ones that we record for visually impaired listeners, we record essentially page by page. Now, this doesn't necessarily mean interrupting the reader, although it sometimes does, but what we do is we group all the headings together in this little... you can see this little EDL here. For the first page of a chapter, for instance, that one.
A good cafe on the Place Saint-Michel.
And then each page is just grouped at a convenient point.
And I asked the waiter for a dozen Portuguese.
This is just done for ease of navigation for the visually impaired users at the other end. But one of the reasons for working in Sadie like this is that it's actually very easy to move all these things around, cut them around, you can rename things on the fly, all while it's still recording. I mean, I know it's not the only system when you can do that, but it's very convenient. Another useful point, although not one that we overuse, is that if you go into this other mode here, you can actually see, I hope that that's actually clear on there, you can see the edit points, if I lift this up slightly. So if I switch that mode off again, it all just looks like one particular, one grouped file. But doing that, you can see one take ended there, another take ended there, another take ended there. So that if at the end of the day you are unsure about any of the edits you've done, you can go back and check them, because it's obvious where they fall. So those are the two methods. I've demonstrated at least one of them for you. Something that's made a huge difference to how audiobooks are recorded, even just within the last couple of years, has been the development of the iPad. Now, there's always been the possibility that the option has always been there that readers could read from a screen. However, if you're talking about a computer screen, you then have twin problems of either having to have the computer desk unit or whatever out of the room because it would be making too much noise in order for you to read from that convincingly in a silent atmosphere. And there's also the how does one navigate it? If the reader's got to sit there with a keyboard and a mouse and move up and down through a text file, you'll hear little clicks, you'll hear little movements. Essentially, for a modern commercial or library-based audiobook, you shouldn't be hearing any noise at all other than the narrator reading. You might do, things do slip through the net, but you shouldn't. This is where reading from an iPad has made a huge difference. It was something I first mooted about 2.5 years ago now, not long after I bought my first one. We had a narrator coming in to read a commercial book for a new client. I was aware there was a problem in getting a hold of a printed version of the text for the reader. I was looking at this on the Friday afternoon and the text still hadn't turned up. I simply went and bought the book from Amazon for Kindle and had it on this, so that when the narrator came in on Monday morning, we said we had a copy of the book there for him, which he could read from. And now it's becoming standard. Not everyone does it, because a lot of the narrators who've been doing this for 30 years still prefer to work with paper. They prefer to be able to scribble on it, stop, turn over the page. Just they're used to reading books, basically. But this is taking off in a very big way, and I don't know if you can actually read the text there, but that's not really relevant. If you're sitting here reading, say, this is from a book called The Demon Parallel, which I'm prepping to record sometime in the new year. Chapter 14, The Demon Drink. And there you go. Morgan thumped a pair of battered metal tankards full of blue frothing liquid on the table. "What's that?" said Cameron. "I apologise, I'm not actually a performer, as you can tell." And all I have to do is just keep reading. I mean, ultimately, if the narrator never made a mistake, you wouldn't need to stop at all. You do, but it's been a basically an absolute revolution in the industry, I think, and something that anyone who's thinking about going into it should be aware of up front. There is a massive world of difference between an audiobook and an audio play, or a radio play, as you might think of it. There are, however, sort of varying shades along the spectrum. It is possible to have things like an audiobook with well, what you might call an enhanced audiobook, I suppose. There are elements of sound design in there, but it's not totally immersive. You're not meant to be thinking that you're in the scene with a number of actors who are all reading aloud. Now, a discussion, it's really important, I think, to establish those terms and exactly what you mean by them, because an awful lot of people, even working in the industry, talk about audio drama and audio books as if those are interchangeable terms, or they work uniquely within one sphere and don't really understand the other, but still continue using the same terminology for both. I've got here an email that I received, when was this, 30th of October, so just about 3 weeks ago, as I read, from an audiobook industry professionals group on LinkedIn, which I'm a member of. The headline on the discussion on the forum is "Audiobooks with a Full Cast." And so you go in and going in and clicking on the discussion, a different kind of audiobook released. A typical audiobook will hire one reader to read the entire book, but new fiction takes the audiobook to the next level. As the reader, one is basically not alone. In each audiobook, one will be joined by a dozen actors who bring the story to life. It's kind of like the old radio shows from the past, the ones where the actors huddled around the microphone. If I found it sort of slightly disconcerting and slightly amusing to receive an email that said that, because full cast audio drama is how I've spent the vast majority of the last 10 years. that's what I've been doing. And it seems to you that what we have here is someone who produces audiobooks and is entirely unaware that anyone's ever done this before. Either done radio drama or continued to do radio drama, since you might think of its heyday, maybe 50 to 60, 70 years ago. And also not aware that many companies who are producing audiobooks or who are producing audio drama for a smaller niche market work along this spectrum. They have moments where the sound design is there. There is an environment in which the listener is placed, and the narrator or multiple narrators sometimes do play more than one part, and you're meant to become immersed in a scene, and then you're lifted out of it again because it goes back to narration. It's sometimes quite a difficult thing to get people to understand, but I was surprised by that, and I think it's worth therefore emphasising the difference.
Right. Well, that was an odd one, wasn't it? Remember, you can also get in touch too with the number on your screens. And now we're returning to Eagle Hill Cemetery again, hopefully without the interference this time. Sorry.
A little bit too stilted, yeah. Just coming from the top of that page, because everything before that was okay, thank you.
Alive, over and over again. She must have been very bad. That's all I have to say.
Well, that's it.
So yes, in terms of thinking about sound design for audiobooks and audio plays, one should be aware up front, as I mentioned earlier, that in a lot of cases when it comes to audiobooks, you'll be looking at no sound design at all. You'll just be looking for an absolutely pristine recording of a narrator reading a book with no extraneous sound, with no extraneous reverb, no environment placed on top of it, nothing at all. Just a very clean reading of a very good actor reading a very good book.
This is just a quick experiment to see what sort of sound design some of your average talking books have got. A pile of things that have been picked more or less at random. So this is a kid's 2 CD unabridged title from Shivers, which then is a part of what was BBC Audiobooks / Audio Go.
Stunt Bunny, Rabbit Racer and Medal Mayhem by Tamsin Murray. Read by Kate Harbour. Rabbit Racer. Chapter 1. The New Neighbour.
Let me introduce...
It's a world exclusive. Super Pet's favourite, Harriet Houdini, races a...
So, no on that one. Something a little more serious. This is The Thread by Victoria Hislop, adult title, from Isis Audiobooks, different company entirely.
Isis Audiobooks presents an unabridged recording of The Thread, written by Victoria Hislop, read by Jonathan Keeble. The moral right of the author has been asserted. Chapter 1. Chapter 16.
Within the year... Again, no. Purely just the unabridged reading with absolutely no extraneous sound. The Inn at Rose Harbour.
The Inn at Rose Harbour by Debbie Maycumber. Read for you by Lorelei King. September 2012.
Habits of the House by Faye Weldon, also again from Shivers, which was BBC Audiobooks, / Audio Go.
Habits of the House by Faye Weldon, read by Rula Lenska. The House Awakes.
The Cut by George Pelikanos.
Isis Audiobooks presents an unabridged recording of The Cut.
Read by Jeff Harding.
Written by George Pelikanos. Read by Jeff Harding.
I know that voice anyway.
The moral right of the author has been asserted.
Okay, another children's title, Boom by Mark Haddon.
Boom by Mark Haddon. Read by Paul Checker. Chapter 1. Helicopter Sandwich.
Another children's title, Oliver Twisted. Read by Toby Longworth. I know him well.
Oliver Twisted, or The Witch Boy's Progress, by J.D. Sharp and Charles Dickens. Read by Toby Longworth. Chapter 1, which tells of Oliver Twisted's birth.
And finally, I think this will be enough to be going on with, Charlie Bone and the Hidden King, another kids' title. So that's 4 adult and 4 children's ones we've been trying out with.
Charlie Bone and the Hidden King by Jenny Nimmo. Read by Bill Wallace. The Children of the Red King, called The Endowed.
So yeah, from a pile of 8 randomly selected adult and kids titles, which we just happen to have in the building at the moment, there isn't a single one of them has any sound design or music on at all. which I'd say is probably statistically pretty much the case across the spectrum. I know, for instance, that Rushforce Media, which is a lot of things for direct for audible.co.uk and audible.com, never use any effects or music on any of their titles. It's the same with Shivers and Cover to Cover, which both became under the imprint of BBC Audiobooks, are purely about reading an unabridged title with nothing else involved. Isis, again, they actually grew out of a relationship with the RNIB, as did Oak Hill, purely about recording the voice and presenting the voice. There's nothing else there. I know, for instance, that the Doctor Who Target readings, which Audio Go was, until very recently, publishing monthly, are fully sound designed, fully soundscaped with correct environments, correct spot Foley effects, and fully scored. But that is, I would still say, quite unusual. These sort of things are probably more what you're talking about in terms of audiobooks.
This is partly, I think, due to the length of most books. If you're talking about a radio drama, even in terms of how Big Finish phrased it, as I said earlier on, as trying to make an audio movie, you're really looking at something more than 2 hours long. A 2 CD release is fairly standard, a 1 CD release becoming even more so. So an hour is quite a standard length for something that you think of as an audio drama. However, for an audiobook reading, an hour would only represent something like 9,000 words. That's basically a short story. A novel is generally a lot longer than this. I think average length for a talking book that we produce at the RNIB is 10 to 12 hours. That's why commercial releases tend to come in fairly standard big bulky packages like this. With this one here, it's got 10 CDs in it. Or now it's downloads, obviously, but that's still not... not so many people buy audio drama as downloads just yet. It will happen, obviously, the world's going that way, but people, at the moment, it's such a niche market product that people do tend to prefer to buy them on CD. If I play you a couple of clips here of things that I've worked on, the first one will be a clip of a full cast audio drama, and you'll see that you will be able to hear that there's it's a fully immersive sound design. You're in a room. The actors are in the room with you, they're talking, you're listening to them within this room. The sound design that is there is meant to engage you as being a totally realistic environment.
You got everything fixed then?
All ship shape. Just blew a fuse, that's all.
So did Maggie.
Carolyn.
I noticed you were ready for another.
Oh, thanks. Here you go, Mr. Bartender.
Be right back with your change, Miss Customer.
So, Amy... what's this book you're dying to get back to? Is it one of your college books?
It's all about the concept of dualism with regards to the spiritual world. So it's looking at the difference between men and women, good and evil, black and white, yin and yang. It's really interesting.
Yeah, it sounds it.
And now this clip is basically just about a raw audiobook reading.
It seems more important to define if homeopathists can genuinely control patients' symptoms and less relevant to have concerns about whether this is due to a genuine effect or to influencing the placebo response. I'm not a doctor, but I'd have thought it was more important to concentrate on that whole genuine effect thing, especially if we are shelling out millions of pounds a year for a few hundred quid's worth of sugar.
Okay, and now I'll... sort of fill in the gaps in between, if you like.
Bullying went on every day and no one ever did a thing to stop it. If I wasn't so good at running, it would have been much worse. Maybe everyone thought it was fair. My family hurt everyone, so everyone's family should get a chance to hurt me. Why don't you ever fight back? I stared at him. What? I've seen you. You don't stand up for yourself. Stand up for yourself? I stared into the fire. He was just like the hog.
As I say, if an audiobook is around 10 to 12 hours long, that's quite an undertaking to put full sound design on it. What often happens, even in those very limited number of cases where there is sound design there, where there is music put on top of it as well, that it's just topping and tailing, sometimes in between chapters, sometimes in between parts. If a book comes in three volumes, say there'll be a little bit of music or a little bit of sound, just punctuating things at high dramatic points or at points where the scene breaks. it's rare to get anything more than that on a mainstream audiobook. I'll play you an example of something that I produced about 3 years ago. It's here somewhere. This is an autobiography which I produced myself and sold as an MP3 CD, just as a single disc. So this is approximately, I think, 10 hours long. Well, it's 12 hours long, actually. Yes, it's longer than I thought it was. The book came in three volumes. And basically, there's just a little bit of sound at the top and end of each part.
Harry once told me that there's a story in everybody. This is mine. When Harry met Sheila, the autobiography of Sheila Stiefel, written and read by Sheila Stiefel. To Tucker Ashworth, Jeanette Hareworth, DH, and Crispin and Ben. Prologue. I, Stedford. The word transports me not to some grand venue in Wales, but to Johannesburg's town hall in South Africa. The music begins. I step out, left hand on hip, right hand on hat, and step, kick, step, kick, step, kick, step.
And for something of that length, that's really all you need to sell the product. Even that isn't essential, but it's just giving it a nice little touch. Because trying to do any more than that turns the project into something that's unwieldy, I think, for commercial release. If you're trying to do 10 hours worth of fully immersive sound design, especially for a piece of non-fiction, which that is, and a lot of work in the field is, it becomes both creatively and commercially impossible. I think generally, if you're thinking of sound design as applied to audiobooks, for the most part, what you're looking at is things which are for children, so fairly short, one or at most two CDs, or franchise work, that is anything that's based on a TV show or a movie, where any product which is brought out within that franchise will be branded. So not only will the packaging have all the correct logos and so on it, they'll expect to use the same theme tunes, incidental music and sound effects as the source material, whether that be a movie or a TV show. So, for instance, a lot of the work I've done over the last 10 years or so, whether for Big Finish or for the BBC Direct, has been working on Doctor Who, which is, of course, a franchise and at the moment a very popular and important one. There's quite a lot of guidelines as to what you should and shouldn't do, especially now, rather than in the few years when Doctor Who was off the air. But it would be expected that you use, for any given era of the show, you would use the correct theme tune, the correct TARDIS sound effects, that sort of thing. I'll play you a little bit of something I made called Day of the Cockroach, about 2-3 years ago now. This is read by one of the stars of the TV show, Arthur Darvill. I didn't actually record this, I just did the post-production for it. It's largely set underground in some fairly cramped locations. But this is an absolutely perfect example of what you think of as an enhanced audiobook. It's an hour long, it's not quite an audio drama, there's only one voice on it, the voice of Arthur Darvill. He is pretending to be not only Rory, the character he plays, but everyone else, and he's the narrator. So I'll play a little bit of this, and hopefully you can hear the difference between the narration and where the characters in situ appear.
Can't you work any faster, boy? Arthur Harrington demanded.
I'm doing my best, said Rory. He was on his hands and knees by the bunkroom wall, attempting to unscrew a ventilation grill with a 2p piece from his pocket. Harrington stood over him, providing torchlight. How come you never tried this yourself if you're so keen to escape? Asked Rory.
Because I didn't have a suitable coin, the old man snapped.
I thought you were rich.
This might surprise you, but I packed in rather a hurry when I heard the warning siren. I didn't think to fetch along my petty cash tin.
Okay, seethed Rory as the coin slipped out of a screw thread and he grazed his knuckles on the grill. Whatever you say.
So for a project like that, one gets the edited production, the entire narration from start to finish, sometimes even just as a single WAV file, or if it's a much longer project, maybe it's two or three WAV files. It's then a case of going in and separating the narration from any actual character voices, because the character voices you want to put within the room. So sometimes even within one line of the text, you will have two or three characters speaking and reacting to each other and the narrator, all just, you know, within one paragraph, say. If you have some kind of mental picture, which as you should do as the producer of this, that say character one is here and quite close to you as the listener, character two is more distant, therefore will have more reverb in their voice, and the narrator is omnipresent, he's everywhere, but will crucially not be reverberant in the same way. You might have just a tiny little bit of reverb to keep the voice warm and beefy, if you like, but the narrator will not be in the same room as everyone else. So essentially it means that when you come to splitting up these voices, the narrator's voice is sent to one bus, all the other voices are sent to another bus, which is the same bus that any Foley effects, environmental effects, reverberation or whatever are all applied to as well. So that all of those become part of that scene, and the narrator sort of sits above it in a different environment. Absolutely critical difference though between an audio play and an audio book is the timing of what you're listening to. In an audio play with a number of actors all giving different lines and all reacting to each other, basically everything you hear is in real time. In an audio book it's very, very different, because not only will there be such things as, you know, he said and she said at the end of lines, the setting of a scene will probably be quite a slow process, because characters will have to enter a room or enter an environment. That environment will be described. This is generally done in a audio play with a few curtains back type sound effects. If you're suddenly walking through a busy London street, you'll hear the traffic, you'll hear people walking. You will have no reverberation as such, because it's an open air that is not enclosed for things to reverberate. You might have you might remove some of the bass to sort of slightly emphasise the fact that nothing is bouncing back from near walls towards you. If you're indoors in a small cramped room like this, my project studio at home is, you'll create essentially a plug-in to emulate the room size, and you'll have noises generated, whether you create those noises or record them as Foleys or do whatever you do. They will be applied to that room as the characters walk into it. In an audio book, where it's a reading, that's totally, totally different. You might still have the same sounds, but the timing of them will be very different. You would probably actually introduce those under the narrator starting to describe the room, but also the action that happens within that room will have to be very carefully designed and gauged. It can't happen in real time to anything like the same degree. If the narrator's reading about two characters slowly walking into a room and seeing things, that might be 2 minutes of audio time. You can't just keep those footsteps going, it'll sound ridiculous, it'll sound as if the room's 20 times the size it is. Or if, for instance, you've got a chase scene or a battle scene in an audio drama, although they're quite difficult to design because you don't want anything to overwhelm the senses too much, you want to still be able to hear what people are doing, you want to be able to follow the plot of what you're listening to, but it will at least happen in real time. If someone fires a gun, you'll hear them fire a gun. If it hits someone, you will then instantly hear that bullet hit them, or that ray gun hit them if it's science fiction or whatever it is. All of this will just happen, and the script will have been devised in such a way that anything you need to be told which isn't visual will be there in the dialogue. It's an easy trap to fall into of, oh, look at that red curtain over there, and yeah, look at this large room we're walking into, and there's someone pointing a gun at us. That's bad audio scripting, although it does happen. But regardless of that, the point is that you will create a realistic scene that they're involved in. Everything, the timing of it will be as if it was actually happening in front of you, as if you were watching it in a film almost. In an audiobook, it has to be more restrained. You can't just create a battle scene and then try and time it for how the narrator reads it, because it's just not going to work in the same way. So I think that's probably the most crucial difference between a full cast drama and a narrated, enhanced audiobook, if you like, is that you've got to be a little bit more restrained in what you're doing. You're not creating an audio movie in anything like the same way. One thing I would very much stress, though, is that if you're thinking of sound design as applied to audio in general, but certainly to audiobooks, is that it has to be more muted than it would be, say, on TV or film. It's entirely possible that if you're watching a TV show, you might get 2 or 3 minutes without dialogue or with very minimal dialogue, where the pictures, and to a lesser extent, but a definite extent it does happen, the sound are telling you the story. You'll hear someone walk into a room, you'll be looking at it through the gloom, and over, and you will hear from behind you, if you're listening to 5.1, you know, a door slam, and think, oh, someone else has entered the room. No one's talking at any point. This is the sort of thing that TV and film can do quite easily. Or similarly, it can do spectacle, massive, you know, battle scenes, thousands of spaceships all firing at each other, alien monsters rampaging, all that sort of thing. Where, if there is dialogue, it's likely to be fairly minimal and fairly functional. Just people shouting or gasping or screaming or whatever. They're not actually, they won't, the characters won't actually be having long conversations at that point. So the sound designer and indeed the incidental musician have a lot of scope to play with when it comes to TV and TV and film. You have to be a little more careful when it comes to audio plays, because almost always, and there are the few exceptions, will be very clearly marked out in the script usually, almost always you're relying on the dialogue being absolutely clear and telling the story. And any other sound that you have there, whether that be the Foley sound, the environmental sound, or the music, that's supporting the dialogue rather than being to the foreground in itself. There are, as I say, there are exceptions to this, but that's generally the way to look at it. In an audio drama, the script, the words in the script are paramount, and your function is to support those words and not to impose yourself on them. That's even more the case when it comes to an audiobook. In an audiobook, you should hear every word, because the point of the book is you're supposed to read every word. A book is written to be read internally, and each word is there for a specific reason, if it's a decent writer. Obviously, not every book is written by a decent writer, but the point stands. If you're then putting some kind of sound there to enhance that reading, it's there to enhance the reading, it's not there to replace it. You shouldn't be drowning it out with sound design, you shouldn't be drowning it out with music. The words should always be audible, always clear, and anything you do fits in with them. To just sort of slightly go back to something I said a moment ago about timing, as I said, obviously you can't have the same realism of sound design in an audiobook because of the pacing that the words will come at you. What you can, however, do is use those words as a framework on which to hang your sound design. Something I quite often do, as I say, I work a lot in the sphere of science fiction and sort of action adventure type dramas. There's very often explosions. If it's an audiobook as opposed to an audio drama, someone will say to them, and then there was an explosion in the corner of the room. Because the word explosion has, by its very nature, a plosive sound in it, you can actually time what you do very nicely such that the explosion happens on the p of explosion. And that means that you're giving the reading a natural pace, because the reader who is reading that script will generally, instinctively, or at worst, be directed to sort of lift the performance slightly when something explodes, when something action-packed happens, and then calm down for the calmer scenes. And I think you that's a sort of very specific example of how you take your cue from what the narrator sounds like. They will be, you know, they will be telling you the story, as I say, and you're there to support that. But you can find clues within how they read it in order to decide exactly where you put your sounds and to what extent the sound design is necessary. So I mentioned earlier about the length of talking books having a direct impact on the presence or otherwise of sound design in there. And I think that's actually quite a crucial point to go into a lot more detail on, because as well as being a recorder, producer, editor, engineer, all of those things in whatever order they're supposed to come, I'm also a publisher on a small, very small level. And which means that I not only take the creative decisions as to what's being, you know, what one does to the audio on a minute-by-minute basis, but I actually, I'm in some cases editing the original text to be published as a book, and then in parallel as an audiobook. Now there's one here, which I think I showed you a little while earlier, it's a novel called Precious Liars. This was the first of the of four books by this writer that I decided to do as a fully unabridged reading, which meant it was going to take around 3 days to record and then probably about the same amount of time to edit afterwards. And it was the intention was this was just going to be a pure audiobook, if you like, no additional sound at all. And then I changed tack just for a moment in the middle of it. If I demonstrate that to you now, but there is one chapter, which is chapter 6, which consists of quite a lot of overlapping voices. The idea being that we're in a cafe, restaurant, bar with the lead character, and he and we, as the reader stroke listener, are being slightly confused by the fact that there are several conversations going on at once. Now when Matthew, the writer of this book, read it himself, when he was reading that, I was actually having trouble following where we were at any given second, even though he was giving the different characters different voices. It just became a little bit more confusing as an audio piece than it was a piece on the page. On the page you can slow down, take the page at your own pace. If you're not quite sure who's talking at any given second, you can just go back a page and start again if you want to. Now you can do that with audio, but it's not as easy, and also it's not as convenient. And I just decided that using just a tiny little moment of sound design for that one chapter was just going to sell that one slightly confusing moment a little bit better than leaving it raw. So other than that, actually, this is completely empty of sound, of extraneous sound rather. I'll demonstrate how I did that as well.
She exhaled sadly. So right now we're kind of waiting on Gale. And it's not even like he was ever any damn good in bed, he wasn't. He was just really selfish, which is him all over. So right now we're kind of waiting on Dave. Asked Tony into the soup of other talk. So right now we're kind of waiting on the lawyer.
Not even broke up. Gee, did I order that? What I really need is a rush of caffeine, gol darn it. Can I have a coffee too?
And the thing is, there's not just the play. I'm finishing off a screenplay about two college girls. One's white and one's a Native American. And they model themselves on the Lone Ranger and Tonto and drive across the country doing good deeds. And it's a romantic comedy. And they meet these two soft-hearted guys out west. One's kind of Tom Cruise and the other's kind of Will Ferrell. And it's got some really good one-liners in it. And Dave says it's really hilarious. And he says he knows a guy in Hollywood.
What sort of books do you write, Tony? Kids' books? Maybe we could collaborate. I could do the illustrations.
Shit. Really bad stuff. I never wrote a kid's book yet. Maybe I will one day. Mainly I write novels. There I was in my head, blaming my cleaning girl, and then it happens again. Tony had a sudden thought. Might make a good studio. It's two stories high and well lighted. It's not far from Barrow Street.
I think it's probably worth just explaining how one approaches the sort of sound editing and sound design aspect of various different projects. This is a talking book, a purely unenhanced talking book. And, well, sound, let's start from over here somewhere.
A deep rose-red butterfly smears the dawn sky over the city. It descends earthward towards Washington Square and then up, over the roofs of Jones Street, where it drops again, passing a large billboard advertising a Broadway thriller, on which a black shadowy figure wielding a knife stands against a background of red so exactly the butterfly's red that for a moment the tiny wing-beating creature is lost.
Yes, so that's, as I say, purely a talking book. In the recording, I did use rock and roll in the recording of this one, so at the end of the final session we basically had a finished product, just needed the odd little tweak as I went in. When I record rock and roll, I tend to record using a system called SADIE, which is widely used in audiobooks, and it's very widely used for radio production. It's great for being able to edit and group things on the fly, as I think I might have explained earlier. I then would then render each chapter in this instance as a single audio file. I've then brought these into, I use Cakewalk Sonar for my final mastering on a PC. I use a Mac for all my admin and a PC for all my actual sound design work, which is exactly the opposite way around from what most people do. But I like SADIE, not least because I firmly believe Pro Tools to be the work of Satan. And each one of these can then just be rendered out as an individual chapter and ready for either burning to CD, which I've done a limited run of in this case, or uploading to Bandcamp, or ultimately I'm planning on working with Audible at some point in the future as well. But in each case, what I'll be rendering out here is just a single stereo WAV file for each chapter.
Around the butterfly, the skin of the hip in this summer heat in the white room is whiter than moonlight on the Hudson.
Lovely little floral book there. Okay, moving sideways. Now this, I'll come to that one next actually. This is actually a scene from an audio drama. The way Big Finish tends to write and record audio drama, Big Finish being the company I've done most of this for over the years, is actually in scenes, as if it were on television. So this is scene 3 out of, I think, something like 17 scenes in this 1 hour long drama. So this is a scene which is actually has two different versions of one character, one of which is from a parallel dimension. You can tell that this is science fiction kind of stuff, can't you? In each case, there might be a little bit of movement of characters. Now, we've actually only got two voices in this scene, and one of them's only got one line in the distance. But you can, you know, this is pan and volume effects and, you know, any other effects you want to apply to each one. So each character has his or her own stream. These will all be sent to different buses. I tend to actually have separate buses for dialogue and effects, even when I'm applying exactly the same processes to those. In this case, it's purely just a light compression and a perfect space reverberant environment. There's absolutely nothing else going on here. That's purely so I can mix in stems quite easily. There are lots of different techniques for doing that if you want to. This is just the method I've evolved for myself that I'm happiest with. So for instance, here are what the voices would sound like.
Uncle Pa!
He's dead, Jonah. Deal with it.
So he's in a cellar and it's a chap essentially talking to himself, but it's an alternative version of himself.
What's on the other side?
You can hear it's quite reverberant.
An eagle. You're not really looking. Look at the...
So that's what the voices sound like. I have also created some ambient sounds, if you like. This is just what... They're in a basement, so it's a little creaky, a little bit strange and echoey. Quite a lot, you know, possibly a suggestion of rats rustling in the distance, that sort of thing. And a little bit of dripping water also. That just is more or less consistent throughout that scene. There's very little changes in that. That's a separate group of tracks that I call ambience, and then that might change as the scene proceeds, but it generally doesn't. It's generally just there throughout. Switch ambience off. And then this is sport effects. This is things that actually come in and out. So, someone phoning someone. Just a little bit of movement. That's a coin spinning, although that might not sound obvious. And this is the slightly eerie sound of possession, of someone coming face to face with their own double from an alternative dimension. And just the occasional other sound of someone rummaging through drawers, looking for something. So ultimately, in the final analysis, all three of these get mixed together.
And Stoddard? Yes, she is.
Creating a sort of immersive effect.
It doesn't concern you. In fact, nothing does. give my regards to Uncle Bob.
He's just been thumped and smashed against the wall.
Carolyn Stoddard, it's time to dance.
Sorry, it's a very melodramatic franchise that I enjoy it very much, though. Don't need to save that, I was just doing it. This is a similar one, though, but this is in the range of enhanced audiobooks, so these actually have narration as well as dialogue. I hope the distinction between these things is clear. If it's not, I haven't been explaining myself very well. But narration is an omnipresent voice over the top of whatever else is going on. Dialogue is obviously when characters in the scene interact with each other, and in this case, and this is generally the case, played by more than one different actor. So if I play a little bit of the narration at the top.
A sunny October afternoon, the docks of New York City. A seemingly happily married couple
is probably
about to board a...
Quite difficult to tell, but that's actually more or less unfiltered recording. You don't... Narration should be fairly clean and you shouldn't do anything much to it. As opposed to dialogue, where these characters are outside on a windy harbour.
Hold up, we're coming!
So I've actually taken quite a lot of the bass out of that, and those characters are moving around as they speak.
Oh, I didn't think we'd make it.
You know I couldn't let you down, my dear.
Let me down!
And similarly, the ambience is there as well. This is the background noises of waves, wind, other people around on that harbour. And in terms of spot effects, this is actually quite a limited scene for that, but the only one we really have is the two characters arriving at the top and running in, and then later on, slightly more slowly, just moving around in the same deck. And it all compiles together, essentially, to make this.
Forces that will leave terror and destruction.
And actually, what you might notice is there is that...
Forces that will lead terror and destruction.
Now, contrary to what I might have said elsewhere, some of the sound is actually drowning the narration there slightly. But that's because I'm mixing these in stems. I will then, when it gets to the actual final mix, I will mute that environment quite a lot more than that until the characters run in at this point of the scene. It's simpler just to mix that all at one level and then worry about the intricacies of where it should and shouldn't be there at a later stage. Or at least I find it so. Not everyone would do, but as long as you get the end result, it doesn't really matter too much. So then,
hold up, we're coming!
There they come.
You know I couldn't let you down, my dear.
And actually, even I can tell, listening to that at this stage, it's probably not quite as obvious, sort of condensed through the small microphone in this camera. But the background is actually slightly drowning out the dialogue here as well. But again, that becomes an issue for at the next stage, which is the sort of compilation of scenes, which I will find for you. I will still continue to have different tracks for narration, theme tune, this is voices, and this is effects. And so this is the same, basically the same moment, but in a different project.
Forces that will leave terror and destruction in their wake.
So you can see, as well as hear, that I'm slowly ramping this background sound up. There's a theme tune there playing underneath and that's fading out. And I'm slowly ramping the dialogue up as well. Also, the dialogue's boosted about 3 dB above the ambient sound.
I didn't think we'd make it.
You know I could.
And even then, I think at the final stage, which is mastering stage, I still mix these out as stems and create the master from that, which will also probably have incidental music on it. I will still be tweaking relative levels at that point, just making sure that at all times you can hear the dialogue over the top of whatever else you've put there in the way of sound. Just to demonstrate the sort of variety and the range of what I've been asked to do over the last few years, here are a pile of different things that I've worked on, and I'll explain what each of them is. This one is a thing called Blue Box Boy, which is an abridged audiobook. I've not done very many of those, and I wouldn't choose to do many of those. This was actually initially for an independent publisher who commissioned me to make it as an abridgment. That's essentially just a pure reading. There's nothing else much to it. There's one or two little punctuated moments of sound design, and I think there might be a tiny bit of music at one point, but minimally so. That's something I produced, say, about 3 years ago. It's now my own company's actually releasing that at the moment.
One chunk of this scene remained in Matthew's memory ever after. The Doctor talked about Bombay Duck. "Things are not what they appear to be," exclaimed the Doctor, "like Bombay Duck." The door in the wall opened and John Nathan Turner emerged. He was younger than Matthew had expected, scarcely into his mid-30s. He had a neat beard and black curly hair, only slightly disorganised, and a circular face which was not fat. At his desk, John said, "This character is an artful dodger type. Oi, Dr. Roo, are we going to Earth or what?" "But we don't want Cockney dialect. Speak in your ordinary accent." "Doctor, are we going to Earth by any chance?" Too soon it was over. As John stood up and went to a filing cabinet, he said, "See you soon." Matthew analysed this comment as the tube rattled through tunnels. He turned the phrase in his head. He filtered every possible meaning.
Moving sort of slightly up the scale towards audio drama, or along the scale rather than up the scale. I mean, they're different projects, they're different types of projects. That doesn't mean that they're, you know, one is of more value than the other. This is a thing I made for the BBC about a year ago, last Christmas, I think. A Doctor Who title called The Devil in the Smoke, which is, again, it's a single reader, and it's an unabridged reading of about 10,000 words. Maybe a little more than that, actually. It's nearly 2 hours, maybe about 17,000 words, something along those lines. But it's a single reader, but it's in enhanced audiobook form. There is environmental sound, there's music, there's occasional spot effects, but not too many of them.
A short while later, and a smaller snowball formed the head. Between them they lifted it and placed it on top of the body. The snowman was now taller than they were, so the task of balancing frosty head on snowy shoulders was not straightforward.
This was the first example that I worked on of a thing that Big Finish Productions make, which they call dramatic readings. This one is a two-hander. They're generally two or sometimes even one reader. The idea being that the format was devised to find a way of presenting stories, including characters who were played by actors who've since died, so they have to be represented in another form. So rather than just hiring another actor to play the part, which is not something that this fan base would appreciate so much, they're basically done as short stories and read as short stories, with occasional dramatic sections therein where another character actually talks to and interacts with the narrator. Otherwise, it's mostly narrated just by the single person who plays not only the character that they played in the original TV show way back in the day, but every other part that crops up as well. Now, this is a format that, as far as I'm aware, and I'm fully willing to be corrected on this, but I think Big Finish essentially invented this. I came to this, this is the second run of them that they did, and I worked on that one. I had no idea at that time how to make this. I was presented with a script and a recording that had been done, and told, "Go away and turn this into a finished product." With one voice, and with one and a half voices, if you like. There are two actors, but one of them's only minimally present, and only in certain scenes. And so it became a case of, well, it has to sort of fit halfway between fully cast audio drama and an audio book. It just required a lot of thought and creativity as to how much sound and how much sound is needed and how little sound you can get away with, in a way that would be just it's not the same approach at all as it would be if this was a full cast audio drama.
The dark tunnel was cold inside. I almost tripped over Semyon where he lay shivering on the floor.
The poor fellow has hypothermia, said the doctor, and he draped his cloak round Semyon and we lifted him out into the sunshine. He was in bad shape. His skin had gone frosty white, and his hair was white too. Summer's over, he whispered. I need a new coat. Dodo took one look.
You know what it's like? Like those animals that change their fur for winter.
Camouflage, I said. Don't be silly. The doctor was examining Semyon's skin.
Again, just moving slightly up the scale. This is a play based on the American series Dark Shadows, which I'm now actually producing. This is an abridgment of a full-length novel, which was presented in two parts. This was very early on in the stage of Big Finish doing these enhanced audiobooks. So this one's actually just one reader. It's actually being read by the author, who was also an actor who was in the original show back in the late 60s and early 70s. And again, this was quite a tricky one to do because it came around the same time as the one I presented a moment ago, Mother Russia. We were looking at the book and thinking, well, at this point, it's a reader who's travelling across continents, or then it might have 10 pages set in one room in one house. How much sound is necessary and how much music is necessary? It's a thing that you can't really, teach as such. It's a matter of using your imagination and your creativity to think, do we need extraneous sound here? Do we need music here? Do we not? It's generally most applied at scene junctions or at scene dramatic high points that you will have to punctuate the action with bridging music or bridging sound design, or if someone leaves one room and enters a different environment, sort of say leaving a house to go outside, you will have the outside noise very present at the start of the intersection between scenes. And then it'll fade, it'll vanish as you go on, because it doesn't necessarily need to be there throughout the next 500 words or whatever where the character is inhabiting that scene. I mean, this, as I say, this came quite early on in Big Finish's sort of dipping their toe into this medium. They've now done hundreds upon hundreds of similar things in all sorts of different franchises. They've worked on things like Robin Hood and Highlander and Stargate, all based on this sort of format rather than the full cast format. The full cast is more involving, it's more immersive, but it's an awful lot more expensive and takes a lot longer to produce. So sometimes this is the best way to go in terms of being able to afford to produce anything at all.
She had never realised the forest was so lush, with trees reaching into the clouds. Angelique felt a longing she did not understand, as though the mountain were calling to her. It was queer walking through the heavy gate once again. The plantation was deserted. The windmill revolved slowly, but the crushers were silent. Stacks of dry cane lay scattered, the breeze rustling the papery stalks. Images flashed across her mind as Angelique climbed the stairs to her old room. Everything was where she had left it a year ago. The room behind the altar seemed smaller and dingier than she had remembered. The book of spells was lying in the corner, covered with grime, and she left it there. She lifted the curtain and walked into the sanctuary. She stood before the altar, listening to the wind whistling outside, and said goodbye, as she had beside her mother's grave, to all her dark powers.
A thing that I made myself for my own company a couple of years ago. This is a spoof. It was actually written as a one-man theatre play by my friend Tony, based broadly on the writer Dennis Wheatley and his life and work and politics and various other things. In conversation with Tony, we decided that this could work as an audio presentation. We actually split it into five short episodes of about 15 minutes each, which were available to download. It's the tale of a man dictating his final book And it's he's a horror writer and a writer of grotesques. He, however, starts to... He finds his writing session being interrupted by the phone, by people coming in and annoying him. And so it was an interesting experiment of being immersed in the moment of sound that the narrator was creating and then being brought out of it by, say, the phone ringing or a sudden twinge of pain or whatever. There's all sorts of different things that happen to the fictional writer of this piece of work as it develops. I think I'm very proud to have done, actually. It's a great little piece. It's difficult to believe now, looking back at this, that this wasn't written directly for the audio medium. It suits it so beautifully. And I think that if I could sort of, I might play you a moment of this just so you have an idea of, again, what I'm talking about when you're coming in and out of different immersive environments.
Silence. Be at Grayson Hall in Hampstead tonight at 10 p.m. Do not be late.
The voice laughed cruelly.
Or else your wife will die.
Oh, don't be too hasty, said Charles. Don't kill her before I get there. But the phone went dead. As dead as Marjorie could soon end up being. We must rescue her, his plucky young friend Simon exclaimed. Charles raised an eyebrow. Well, we could. Stirling Towers? Oh, it's you, Grosvenor. Well, yes, I am busy, actually. I have to pay your wretched commission somehow. Well, it's going quite well, in truth. More literary than usual. Oh, well, of course, I still have all the satanic gubbins. I haven't suddenly turned into Iris Murdoch. I know what my public crave. Meaty stories, spunky heroes, slutty heroines, and lots of hocus-pocus. And if I can slip in some subtle political education, then all the better.
And not dissimilar to that last one is this thing called My Gay Best Friend, written by and starring two friends of mine. They again had taken this as, they had written this as a theatre piece, which has been quite extensively performed now, actually, as on a fringe level. They were thinking, toying with the idea of doing it as an audio presentation, and I stepped in and helped them with that. It didn't require much adaptation, but it actually doesn't require all that much extraneous sound. It's got two characters who spend the majority of it, one trapped in a toilet in a nightclub and the other one trapped in a cupboard in his neighbour's house, and they're it's a fairly easy shtick on stage that they then turn and address the audience, and the audio that becomes that they start narrating what they're doing, and then between times they have to respond to sounds that are coming from outside the room that they're trapped in. Again, I might play you a little bit of that just as demonstration.
Hey, Gav.
Gavin.
Shut up. There's a new lad on perfume. He's definitely gay. Do you want me to fix you up?
How old is he?
I don't know. About 20?
Rachel.
Raquel.
Shut up. I'm old enough to be his father. How do you know he's gay anyway?
Because he works on perfume and he's called Piers.
And then there was the other type of call. Hello? Rachel? Is that you? Where are you? Are you at home? Look, darling, stay there. Don't move. Is the key in the normal place? I'm coming over. Don't move. I'll only be 15 minutes. Everything's going to be just fine. We'd sit and she'd cry a bit and then I'd make her a coffee and put her to bed. Or if she was really bad, I'd sleep on the put-you-up in the lounge. I never asked her what it was about. Ah, I knew she'd tell me when she was ready. People always do.
He's got
I got that kind of face.
He's got that kind face.
The other end of the spectrum from the audio book is the full dramatic presentation, such as things like these, which are Dark Shadows. These are actually part of an enhanced audiobook range, a range of dramatic readings, which are expected to be one and two-handers. Myself and the other producer have actually decided we want to slide across the other scale, and so we've employed an awful lot of additional actors to try and make the scenes live and breathe a little bit more than that. We thought that the trying to apply the enhanced reading limitations to it was actually limiting the type of stories we could tell in this instance. So these are in fact basically just full cast audio dramas. which Big Finish has been specialising in for a great many years now.
What with the connection to the sanatorium, we think there might be an escaped patient.
Wait, is this Wincliffe you're talking about? Where Delwith is?
Yes.
Jim, do you think...
No, it's not Delwith. He died this morning.
What?
Heart attack.
And you didn't think to tell us?
We think the killer might be hiding in the cemetery.
Sheriff, I don't know about in America, but in Britain you'd need something like a warrant to remove us.
I'd ask your colleague to show a little more respect, please.
Listen, we've been planning this for months.
Wait.
How else are we supposed to react?
Wait a minute.
I appreciate that, sir, but it doesn't change the situation.
I know people in high places.
Shut up. My God. Can't you hear her screaming?
Kate?
Well, I hope all that's given you some idea of what I mean by... What is generally meant by sound design as applied to audiobooks. Whether by that you mean enhanced audiobooks or going right up the other end of the scale in terms of full cast audio drama, fully immersive audio drama. As I say, there's lots of stops on the schedule in between the two, but they're all valid in their own way. Whether it's just a pure inhabited narrated reading with one actor reading an entire book, or whether it's a full cast audio movie, these are all media that are valid and which are in their own way related. They require a lot of the same techniques. They just might need slightly different creative thought in terms of those techniques. I think I've said everything I had prepared to say essentially, but I'm bound to think of about 25 other things once I switch the recorder off and start editing it. I may interject a few of those as I go. Just one sort of final thing, which I think might give you an interesting flavour of to where the audiobook industry is going, which is the fact that there's an awful lot of people doing DIY audiobooks these days. Now, this is very much just the case in purely the narration. These are books that don't have any sound design, any additional sound effort, any additional music. People basically recording them at home and sending them in. Now, to some extent, this is a little bit worrying for an audio industry professional like me, the fact that anyone might sit and record their own book at home and start selling it online, and the quality won't be of anything like as good as it could be, you know, given a proper producer, a proper engineer, and a really well-equipped studio and proper editing facilities. However, much like the music industry having to accept that people are quite happy with MP3s, there is genuinely the case that for some extent, and certainly for niche market products, people will actually like being able just to read and upload a book very quickly on their own terms. We can't police that. It's not up to me to say you shouldn't be doing that. So what we can to some extent do is embrace it and get involved with it and say, right, okay, audiobook recording has become easier, audiobook upload has now become, you know, audiobook distribution, if you like, has become ridiculously easy thanks to things like Audible. Anyone can kind of put a book up on a site like Bandcamp or SoundCloud, whether they're selling it or making it available for free. But there is not going to be, the call will be there to do things fully professionally, certainly for large mainstream mass market products. You know, the next James Bond book, the next J.K. Rowling book or whatever, these are things that will be done in a professional studio with a really good performer, and the time will be taken to do it properly. There will then be a sliding scale right down to someone who's written a small press run of short stories, reading their own book in their own house and trying to sell that. They may or may not succeed in doing so. The interesting thing though is that I think very much the iPad revolution is going to affect that as well, because it's now hit a stage where if you've got a quiet enough room, you can sit and read from an iPad and record straight onto it as well. Certainly at the moment, I have a setup here. Actually, I'll put this together as I speak to you. Whereby I have two iPads. I've got an old one, which I had which I bought sort of on the first bloom of them. And this has got some PDFs of some scripts on it. I'll just sort of pick one randomly. So yes, using an app on here called iAnnotate, which is a method of not only reading but also marking up PDF files. Here again is this book called The Demon Parallel, which I'm going to be producing sometime in the next couple of months for in parallel with a small Edinburgh-based publisher. This has been written by a friend of a friend called Roy Gill, and I hope it's going to be a very successful book for him. So I've got text there. I can just move that up and down. I have on this other iPad, which is a slightly more up-to-date one, this has got GarageBand installed. And so what I've got here is a fairly newish iPad microphone. It can also plug into a USB port on any kind of any laptop, any other computer. But if I can figure out which way that goes in, there it goes finally. I can sit here and record into this. So it's entirely possible that there are people out there already doing this. I've got GarageBand running here. I've already started recording. I've got this with the text on it. He wiped his hands across his forehead. Judge me not in the performance, as I say, by the way. I'm a producer, not an actor. As he neared the end of the path, he got a better look at the building he'd spotted from the tree. Shaped like a Greek temple, it had a disc for a roof supported by three columns. Although in overall size, it wasn't much larger than an upended ice cream van. That's all the equipment that you need to record a very basic audiobook. I'm fully convinced there are people out there doing it already. So people like me have to learn how to exist in a world where that happens. I don't want that to sound in any way to put anybody off trying to get involved in the audiobook industry, because it is a huge and growing one. But I think it's just that it will continue to expand, but it will fracture a little, I think, into sort of different strata, from, you know, fully professional, expensive audiobooks of very mainstream projects where people are guarding the copyright very carefully, right down to tiny press productions selling a few MP3s but on a recording budget of pretty much zero, because it's recorded by someone sitting in a small quiet room with a couple of these and then editing it all later on. So I hope I've given you some degree of insight into what it is I do all day, every day, and why I think that's an interesting and creative medium to work in, and how I see it to some extent developing in years to come. I think there will still be sound design for audiobooks, but it's a niche industry at the moment. I think it will continue to be so. And it will always be a medium and a product that needs to be explained. People will still think that when you talk about making an audiobook, you're purely talking about someone sitting in a room and reading that book. And 9 times out of 10, that is what you're talking about. If you're making an enhanced audiobook, you're very likely that you're going to have to explain that to customers. You have to explain that to customers at the moment. That, you know, this is not just someone reading, it's got different voices, it's got different sound effects, it's got immersive environments, it's got, you know, fully scored incidental music, or wherever along that continuum you sit. That's something that the customers at the moment still aren't entirely sure of. That needs explained to them time and time again, and I don't see that changing anytime soon. Thank you.